Let me get your view, speaking of the markets, on where we are post-Fed.
Well, I was on a few weeks ago. I think I made the comment that if I was a technician, which I'm not, unfortunately, I'm better off in the last month and a half if I was a technician, I would be bearish. And stocks act dreadful. At that time, 40% of stocks in the S&P 500 down over 20%. It's more now. But, you know, my approach is fundamentally derived. And the things that I look at don't favor the notion that we're heading into a bear market. So my view was then and is now, own your favorite stocks, hold cash, and limit your holdings of bonds. And to the extent you own bonds, keep the maturity shorter than average. And the arguments I would advance against, number one, a bear market is not just a price decline in a short period of time. A bear market is more stocks decline than rising, which we clearly have, goes on for a prolonged period of time. It's not just a 4 or 6 or 8 week correction. It's a correction that goes on for some relevant period of time it is validated by what's going on in the economy. And when I look at the economy is doing okay, it's slowing down a little bit and everybody's hyperbolic, but basically it's slowing down a bit. It's still growing. Employment is growing every month. Okay, number one. Number two, monetary policy. I'm probably in a minority, but I don't think Powell laid an egg like everybody says he laid yesterday. He basically took the dots from 3 to 2, and he said he's going to be dependent upon the data. And what more do you want him to say?
There are plenty of people who wanted him to say, let's go from 3 to 0.
But the interest rate shouldn't be zero. I don't think interest rates are the problem for the stock market. You know, the S&P now is around 2485 or whatever it is. We have an earnings estimate. Again, we're not assuming a recession next year, of 172. The S&P is 14 and a half times earnings. Okay, that's slightly below the long-term average. The long-term average, when the multiple was 15, was 6.5% for 10-year governments. We're currently 2.8. We're less than half. The Fed funds rate averaged 5% in that 50-year period. It's now somewhere between 2.25, 2.5. Every bear market and every recession was preceded by some meaningful real interest rates. Interest rates now are approaching zero in real terms. So, you know, the Fed is not hostile. I mean, if they continue to rise as the market declines, that's going to be a different conversation. But I don't think what they did is so unusual yesterday.
Well, how would you respond, though? You know, I've got next to me, to my left, Mike Wilson of Morgan Stanley, who's been right on the money.
I believe the market is actually lower than he thought it would be at this time, but he's been better than most, no question about it.
And who says we've been in a bear market, right? We've had this rolling bear market for many months.
I said, if I was a technician, which I'm not, I would be bearish. The stocks are dreadful, and they act like we're in a bear market. I don't disagree with that. The question is, what am I going to do today? What am I going to do today at 14 and a half times earnings, where the economy is growing modestly, but it's growing, basically, where my alternative is, 2.8% in the 10-year government, or maybe 2.5 in the shorter-term paper, and I say I want to have a combination of cash and my favorite stocks. You know, if the average stock in the market is down by 20-25% from its peak, there's probably a lot of values within the market.
Lee?
A lot of values within the market. The other thing is, the psychology doesn't seem to be suggestive of a significant top. Monetary policy is not really hostile. Evaluation is reasonable. The economy is okay. I'm not some huge bull. You know, January was on your program. I got caved in a little bit, but I said I thought the market could be somewhere between down 15 to up 10. And I modified that, and I was worried that virtually every strategist, including Mr. Wilson, I think, every strategist in the Bloomberg survey have the market higher at the end of 2019 than it is presently. Everyone. And that's probably something to worry about, right? And that was the same case for 2018. The market is down 4 or 5%, and every strategist in January of this year had the market higher. So, you know, there's plenty to be worried about, but I'm finding a tremendous amount of value in the market, and I'm being destabilized by these electronic guys like everybody else, because I don't understand these moves in concentrated periods of time.
Let me get Mike Wilson in to the conversation to react to what you've heard.
I think Lee's right. I mean, the only place that we disagreed during the year, perhaps, is that I thought there was maybe more risk on the downside. We actually overshot my base case, and now we're getting closer to my bear case because things got a little bit, it got a little accelerated. Okay, but I agree with what Lee said. Now the market is giving you value. It took us a while to get here. Mm-hmm. And so I think what people should really be focused on is, A, yeah, find things you like, but don't overpay for them. So the big mistake that I think people forgot about, I think they forgot about in the last year and a half, is that the companies are putting up great numbers, but they overpaid for it. They overpaid for growth. And you can't do that now anymore, right? That now valuation matters, long-duration assets, not just bonds, Lee, right? Bonds, long-duration bonds are worthless, but long-duration, not worthless, but they're worth a lot less when rates are going up over time. Longest duration assets in the world are growth stocks if they're overvalued. And that's what's being reset. And so now you just have to be really disciplined about what you pay for these assets.
Yeah, you know, it's an interesting thing. I'm not saying it's bullish, but in 2007, I gave a speech at the Value Investing Conference, highly critical about stock repurchase. And, on the one hand, you have to say there was it's now a new record, okay, in 2018, I think over $1 trillion have been repurchased, and that eclipsed the record of 2007, and we know what happened in 2008. But I have to say, if businessmen are pessimistic, you certainly can't see it from their capital allocation decisions. You don't buy back $1 trillion of your stock if you think the outlook is poor. So I think Mike has done an excellent job. I think his points are well taken. And to me, I'm going to have a combination of cash and stocks. And even take a long-duration asset like a Google. I mean, it's over $100 billion of cash in the balance sheet, selling it with 20 times earnings. Mm-hmm. I mean, I think that that's better than cash in my way of thinking.
Lee, I want to thank you so much for being with us today. It's been good having you.
Thank you.
We may not see you or hear from you before the end of the year. Happy, healthy, and I hope we'll have you back in 19.
Same to you and all your viewers. Thank you very much.
Appreciate it very much. That's Leon Cooperman there for you. Let's finish the time we have. 3 minutes left. Let's kick some of this around.
I think the stock market is clearly over-discounted a very severe recession in 2019. And the way we see the Fed, it's neutral to positive, due to the endpoint. Oil is a positive. Tax reform benefits will continue. And multiples are attractive. So prospectively, looking forward, it's an attractive time to add equities for those investors that are underinvested. The timing, not right now because of this incredible vol, but at some point in 2019 Q1, we're going to have some opportunities.
Okay, Brenda?
I would agree with Richard that, you know, when we look at valuations especially, they are becoming much more attractive, particularly for U.S. equities. That's the area where we hadn't been quite as positive versus global equities. But now valuations have come down. Even if you assume just low single-digit earnings growth next year, valuation still looks attractive in our view. So we think that many times, you know, when you're looking to put money to work, it's when it feels the worst that it is the best time. And so we think now is more of an opportunity than anything.
Pete?
You know what, these valuation levels, there are great opportunities out there, but the problem is obviously the bumps and the volatility that these guys are talking about. I think we are finally getting to the level, Scott, where we are at the volatility that belongs in where the market is, given the movement. So don't expect this volatility to suddenly slide off. I think a lot of people think this is a couple day spike. I don't agree with that at all. I think this is here for a while.
Mr. Weiss.
You know, I agree with what you say because of your time frame.
Talking to Rich Saperstein, so viewers
with your investors. However, here's what I'd say, that we don't know what the E is going to be on these stocks. We just don't know. So we can't say they're cheap. If you get a severe recession, I can guarantee you that the valuations right now do not look cheap at all. But your time horizon is very long. Mine is in the core portfolio as well. I just think take time. The risk reward is not attractive here.
With 3.5% unemployment, it's very hard to see the economy slowing and grinding to a halt immediately in the next 6 to 9 months.
Well, you said a severe recession. If we have a severe recession, unemployment won't be at 3.7%. But unemployment will be double that or more.
Not in the next 12 months. Can't turn a steamship around.
I'm not disagreeing with that.
Joe? All right, listen, this is happening at the worst possible time of the year. I agree with you, Mike, and I think that's part of what's going on right now. I think on the other side of this, you're going to have to squeeze out a lot of people that have never seen losing money. It's been straight up the last 7 or 8 years. We squeeze them out, and I agree with Mike. I think there's a tremendous opportunity in equities to be long.